Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Three Worlds, Memoirs of an Arab Jew, by Avi Shlaim, narrated by Neil Shah. Prologue. One hot summer day, my father approached as I was hanging out with friends outside our block of flats in the Israeli town of Ramat Gan, east of Tel Aviv. Unlike my companions and me, in our shorts and sandals, my father wore a three-piece suit, white shirt, and tie. He addressed me in Arabic, a foreign tongue. My reply had to be in Arabic, too. Shame overwhelmed me, and my cheeks turned red. Answers to my father's questions were muddled, monosyllabic, barely audible. What I wanted to say to him was that, while it was all right for us to speak Arabic at home, when I was in company, he needed to speak to me in Hebrew. However, in the presence of my peers, I could not bring myself to say anything. Even later at home, I could not articulate these inhibitions. I just wanted the ground to open up to devour me. Difficulties in communicating were to characterize my relationship with my father for the rest of his life. As a child, I never considered how humiliating this incident must have been for him. This was in the mid-1950s, when I was about 10 years old. I had been born in Baghdad in 1945 to a Jewish family, 3 years before the birth of the State of Israel. My family had moved from Baghdad to Israel in 1950, when I was 5. At home, we spoke Arabic. The language of the young Jewish state was Hebrew, adapted for the modern age from Biblical Hebrew. My sisters and I picked it up very quickly at school and spoke it both with our friends and to each other. My father, in his mid-50s, was still struggling to learn an immensely difficult language. It was only to be expected, therefore, that he would speak to me in Arabic. But for me, this was acutely, almost painfully, embarrassing. Israel had been established by Jews from Europe and prided itself on being part of the West, of what was at the time commonly called the free world. It saw itself, and it presented itself to the rest of the world, as an island of democracy in a sea of authoritarianism. We were Jews from an Arab country that was still officially at war with Israel. European Jews tended to look down on us as socially and culturally inferior. They also despised the Arabic language and what they considered to be its strange guttural sounds. Not only was Arabic the language of the enemy, it was cast as ugly and primitive. An impressionable young boy, I picked up and internalized the beliefs and biases of my new environment. I wanted to turn my back on my Arab heritage, on the culture and customs of the diaspora, and to morph into a Hebrew-speaking new Israeli. Speaking Arabic did not sit well with the new identity I was adopting. This seemingly minor episode encapsulates the emotional turmoil that plagued me throughout my childhood in Israel. Nor was it simply a matter of language. Switching from Arabic to Hebrew was only one dimension of the fundamental change that my parents, my two sisters, and I underwent following our arrival in Israel. 1. Arab Jews. If I had to identify one key factor that shaped my early relationship to Israeli society, it would be an inferiority complex. I was an Iraqi boy in a land of Europeans. Perhaps surprisingly, in my early years, this did not engender a rebellious streak. On the contrary, the status quo seemed the natural order of things. I unquestioningly accepted the social hierarchy that placed European Jews at the top of the pile and the Jews of the Arab and African lands at the bottom. Nor did I believe that I had any special abilities or talents that Israeli society failed to recognize. I entirely lacked the burning sense of injustice that may propel some marginalized children to prove themselves. I saw myself as an ordinary boy with some handicaps and limitations, and no prospect of a bright future. I was lazy, apathetic, alienated from my environment, but at the same time, resigned to my fate. The notion of pulling myself up by the bootstraps was totally alien to my whole way of thinking. At that time, I had no idea that being an Iraqi in Israel might have advantages as well as disadvantages. The main advantage for me in later life was the ability to transcend national stereotypes and to take a more balanced, if not detached, view of the Arab-Israeli conflict. This is no ordinary conflict. It is one of the most bitter, protracted, and intractable conflicts of modern times and spawns intense passions and partisanship on both sides of the divide. Israeli schools and the media to this day promote a skewed version of the conflict in which Israel can do no wrong and the Arabs can do no right. Arab schools and the Arab media similarly purvey a black and white picture which casts the Palestinians as the innocent victims and the Jews, a term often used interchangeably with Israelis, as selfish, cruel, and unscrupulous villains, as uniquely evil. Both sides believe fervently in the justice of their cause. Both adhere to a narrow narrative of history which, like most nationalist narratives, is often simplistic, selective, self-righteous, and self-serving. Having lived as a young child in an Arab country, I was aware of the possibility of peaceful Arab-Jewish coexistence. I could see Arabs not just as an enemy, but as a people, worthy of recognition and dignity. My Iraqi background thus helped me, as I grew up, to develop a more nuanced view, based on empathy for all the parties locked into this tragic conflict. In this respect, I was not typical. A significant number of Iraqi Jews who moved to Israel became Arab-spurning, right-wing nationalists. In my youth, I flirted with right-wing ideas, as I shall describe later. There is no way of telling how I might have developed politically and ideologically had I stayed in Israel. In any case, the right-wing phase in my life was short-lived. Distance from Israel bred in me a more independent and reflective attitude towards Israeli society. The years I spent as a university student in England in the aftermath of the June 1967 war enabled me to see beyond simple certainties and to acquire a more critical perspective on nationalism in general and a more sophisticated understanding of the diverse ingredients that make up the Arab-Israeli conflict. Nationalism, it gradually dawned on me, lies at the heart of most international conflicts. The trouble with nationalism, as Marilyn Monroe wrote in her scrapbook, is that it stops us thinking. This book is a personal story of a young Iraqi Jew told by a professional historian. It recounts my early life up to the age of 18 in Iraq, Israel, and England, but from the vantage point of a scholar of the Arab-Israeli conflict. Virginia Woolf observed that many memoirs are failures because they leave out the person to whom things happened. Here, the impressionable little boy and the troubled teenager are at the center of the story, but the backdrop to the drama is filled in by the mature scholar. My personal experience is used to illustrate and illuminate a much bigger story, the story of the Jewish exodus from Iraq, following the establishment of the State of Israel in 1948. The result is an autobiographical fragment, a family story, and hopefully a glimpse into the rich and lost world of the Iraqi Jewish community. I aim to recover and reanimate a unique Jewish civilization of the Near East, which was blown away in the first half of the 20th century by the unforgiving winds of nationalism. The detached lens of academic analysis does not suffice here, and so I delve into a more intimate history, my family's. We were an upper-middle-class Iraqi Jewish family displaced from Iraq by the combined pressures of Arab and Jewish nationalism, by the push of Iraqi xenophobia, and the pull of the newly born Jewish state. We were part of the mass exodus of Jews from Iraq to Israel in 1950. Our departure from our homeland was due to forces that were completely beyond our control, and even beyond our comprehension. This book began as an attempt to make sense of my early life and to piece together the fragments of my family's history. It ended up as a narrative of family drama during an exceptionally turbulent period in the history of the Middle East. Our family fortunes mirrored that of an entire community, one that was uprooted from a world in which it felt at home to one in which it had to make painful adaptations. Our family story is placed within the broader context that framed it, the history of the Jewish community in Iraq. The story revolves around the settled and mostly contented life we led alongside Muslims in Iraq, the anguish and pain of displacement, the problems of adjusting to a new life in the promised land, my poor performance at school in Israel, which led my parents to send me to study in England, and the 3 mostly unhappy years I spent in London in what amounted to a second exile. What lends our story some broader interest is the fact that we belong to a branch of the global Jewish community that is now almost extinct. We were Arab Jews. We lived in Baghdad and were well integrated into Iraqi society. We spoke Arabic at home, our social customs were Arab, our lifestyle was Arab, our cuisine was exquisitely Middle Eastern, and my parents' music was an attractive blend of Arabic and Jewish. What do I mean by the term Arab Jew? I do not mean Arab as a national identification in the sense of pan-Arabism, a nationalist ideology as young as Zionism. I use the term as a shorthand for describing a shared cultural heritage and language. For all I know, my family tree may stretch back to the exile of the Jews from Judea to Babylon 2.5 millennia ago. Psalm 137 of the Bible expresses the yearnings of the Jewish people during their Babylonian exile to return to Zion, one of the biblical names for Jerusalem, as well as the land of Israel as a whole. By the waters of Babylon, there we sat down, and there we wept, when we remembered Zion. For my family, however, Zion held little lure. We had struck deep roots between the two rivers of Babylon, and we had no reason to want to tear them up. We were Iraqis, whose religion happened to be Jewish, and as such, we were a minority, like the Yazidis, Chaldean Catholics, Assyrians, Armenians, Circassians, Turkmens, and other Iraqi minorities. Relations between these diverse communities before the age of nationalism, despite inevitable tensions, were better characterized as a dialogue rather than a clash of civilizations. Baghdad was known as a city of peace, and Iraq was a land of pluralism and coexistence. We in the Jewish community had much more in common, linguistically and culturally, with our Iraqi compatriots than with our European co-religionists. We did not feel any affinity with the Zionist movement, and we experienced no inner impulse to abandon our homeland to go and live in Israel. In one respect, however, we were not a typical Iraqi Jewish family. On my mother's side, we were subjects of the mighty British Empire. My maternal great-grandfather had left Iraq as a young man to go to Bombay, where he had made his fortune and become a British subject. He returned to Iraq to retire and build a synagogue that was named after him. My maternal grandfather was a British subject by birth who moved from Bombay to Iraq with his parents when he was 16. He later worked as an interpreter for the British consulate in Baghdad. 2 of his 3 sons were recruited by the British Army during the Second World War and served as officers in the intelligence corps. The whole family lived in Iraq, a state founded by the British Empire after the First World War on the ruins of the Ottoman Empire. And in the end, the family was forced to leave the country because, among other reasons, by facilitating the Zionist takeover of Palestine, Britain had helped to fuel Muslim hostility towards the Jews throughout the Muslim world. My father's family were all Iraqi Jews. My paternal and maternal grandmothers, who came to Israel with us, felt great nostalgia for the old Iraq and frequently referred to it as Janamal Allah, the Garden of Eden. For them, Iraq was a beloved homeland, while the land of Israel was a place of exile. their true feeling could have been expressed by a reversal of Psalm 137. By the waters of Zion, there we sat down, and there we wept, when we remembered Babylon. Their personal predicament pointed to a fundamental paradox at the heart of Zionism. Zionism emphasized the historic connection of the Jewish people to its ancestral homeland in the Middle East, but it spawned a state whose cultural and geopolitical orientation identified it almost exclusively with the West. Israel saw itself, and was regarded by its enemies, as an extension of European colonialism in the Middle East, as being in the Middle East, but not of it. In this Eurocentric state, it was impossible for people like my grandmothers to feel at home. My mother, who died aged 96 in Israel in 2021, often talked about the many close Muslim family friends who used to come to our house in Baghdad. One day, when she was over 90, I asked her whether we had any Zionist friends. She gave me a look that implied this was an odd question, and then said emphatically, "No, Zionism is an Ashkenazi thing. It had nothing to do with us." This, in essence, had been my elders' view of Zionism before we were catapulted into Israel, its principal political progeny. Zion was a small, faraway country of which we knew little. Our migration to Zion was one of necessity, not an ideological choice. It is no exaggeration to say we were conscripted into the Zionist project. Moreover, migration to Israel is usually described as aliyah, or ascent. In our case, the move from Iraq to Israel was decidedly a yerida, a descent down the social and economic ladder. Not only did we lose our property and possessions, we also lost our strong sense of identity as proud Iraqi Jews, as we were relegated to the margins of Israeli society. In my later career in England, as a specialist on the international relations of the Middle East and as a public intellectual, I took issue with two dominant narratives: Samuel Huntington's Clash of Civilizations thesis and the Zionist narrative about the Jews of the Arab lands. The former implicitly rules out the possibility of a Jewish Arab identity. The Zionist narrative maintains that anti-Semitism is inherent in Islamic religion, that Islam has been relentlessly persecutory towards the Jews, that hostility to Jews is endemic to all Arab countries, that the Jews of these countries faced the threat of annihilation in another Holocaust, and that the infant state of Israel valiantly came to the rescue and offered them a safe haven. The Zionist narrative further asserts that Arab anti-Semitism is an unmovable impediment to a peaceful settlement of the conflict between Israel and its Arab neighbors. In this reading, the migration of the Jews from Arab lands to Israel is attributed primarily to the persecution and prejudice they allegedly encountered in their country of origin, and their hardline political positions once in Israel are traced to their lived experience among the Arabs. It was only in recent years, however, that I began to reflect on the extent to which my own personal experience helped to shape my worldview and led me to challenge the Clash of Civilizations as well as the Zionist narrative. Samuel Huntington's Clash of Civilizations thesis was one of the buzzwords of the early 1990s. The Harvard professor believed that after the end of the Cold War and collapse of the Soviet Union, the world would revert to its normal state of affairs, characterized by cultural conflict. The most important distinctions among people, he argued, were no longer political or ideological, but cultural. Human beings are divided along cultural lines: Western, Islamic, Hindu, and so on. Islamic culture was presented as basically hostile to the West. People in the Islamic world were said to reject the values of the West. Their primary attachment, Huntington claimed, was to their religion, rather than to their nation-state. And their religion was incompatible with liberal Western ideals such as individualism, pluralism, freedom, and democracy. The now largely discredited clash of civilizations has been a major influence on the approach of some Zionist historians to the Arab-Israeli conflict. These historians view the conflict as rooted in Islamic dogma and hatred of the Jews. Echoing Huntington, they place the emphasis on the religious and spiritual dimension of the conflict. What Huntington and these Zionist historians have in common is an Orientalist mindset. They deal in stereotypes of the East. They explain Muslim hostility towards the West, and by extension Arab hostility towards Israel, as the inevitable product of their religion and culture, rather than of specific historical circumstances. The clash is said to be between Judeo-Christian civilization and Islam. An essentialist view of what it is to be Muslim leads to a reductionist account of the Muslim approach towards the outside world in general and towards Jews in particular. This kind of analysis is hopelessly ahistorical. It collapses the diversity of the Muslim world into one angry, ignorant monolith. And it fails to put into the equation the very real, not imagined, grievances that Muslims have against the Western powers and Israel. This simplistic Eurocentric worldview has a parallel in the worldview of some radical Islamic activists. Radical Islamists maintain that the story of Arab and Jew is the story of a fundamental clash of religion and culture. According to them, the Jews were never part of the fabric of Arab society. They were aliens, a hostile element, even a fifth column in Dar al-Islam, the House of Islam. The State of Israel is seen by them as an illegitimate entity, planted by the colonial powers in their midst, with the aim of dividing and weakening them. Both Zionists and Islamists thus use the history of Muslim-Jewish relations selectively to serve their respective secular and religious agendas. Both groups urge mistrust of the enemy and call for constant mobilization in the struggle for supremacy and domination. The story of my family does not sit well with either the Zionist or the Islamist narrative of the Jewish experience under Islamic rule. At a deeper level, it conflicts with the clash of civilizations premises that underpin both narratives. The story of my family is thus not only interesting in and of itself, it contains possible implications for our understanding of the course of modern Middle Eastern history. More specifically, it serves as a corrective to the Zionist narrative, which views Arabs and Jews as congenitally incapable of dwelling together in peace, and doomed to permanent conflict and discord. Zionism was a 19th century European movement. It offered a solution in the form of a Jewish state in Palestine to the Jews who suffered discrimination and persecution in Europe. In Iraq, by contrast, there was an old tradition of religious tolerance and a long history of relative harmony between the different segments of society. The Jews were neither newcomers nor aliens in Iraq. They were certainly not intruders. The Jewish connection with Babylon goes back to the time of Abraham the Patriarch, who migrated from Ur, south of the city of Babylon, to the land of Canaan. Jews lived in Babylon since 586 BC, when King Nebuchadnezzar destroyed their kingdom in Jerusalem and drove them into exile. Centuries later, Babylon became the spiritual center of the Jewish diaspora and the seat of its most distinguished religious academies, Neharda, Sura, and Pambedita, modern Fallujah. It was there that the Babylonian Talmud was compiled and Jewish halakha law was codified. The Jews were thus firmly settled in Babylon long before the rise of Islam in the 7th century CE. After Iraq became a majority Muslim state, the Jews remained an integral part of Iraqi society. At the time of the First World War, the Jews constituted a third of the population of Baghdad, and it was often described as a Jewish city. After the war, Jews continued to play a prominent part in the social, economic, literary, intellectual, and cultural life of the Kingdom of Iraq. It was precisely that prominence that fed Muslim antagonism towards them in the age of nationalism and growing sectarianism. Under the Ottoman Empire, the Jews had the status of a protected minority with the same rights and obligations as the other minorities. One of the saving graces of the Ottoman Empire was the considerable autonomy it extended to its minorities. Although Islam was the official religion of the empire, Islamic law was not imposed on the non-Muslim communities. The Jews flourished under this pluralist system, and they also benefited from the Tanzimat, the reforms of the late 19th century. They had representatives in the Ottoman Parliament, and they played a prominent part in the finance, trade, and commerce of an empire that stretched from the Gulf of Aden to the eastern edge of Europe. In the modern Kingdom of Iraq, which was formed from three Ottoman provinces following the collapse of the Ottoman Empire, the Jews continued to enjoy the same rights as the other minorities. In Europe, by contrast, the Jews were the minority seen, above all, as the other, and therefore constructed as a problem. Europe had what was often referred to as the Jewish question. The Nazi final solution to this question led to the extermination of 6 million European Jews. Unlike Europe, the Middle East did not have a Jewish question. Anti-Semitism was a European malady that later infected the Near East. Anti-Semitic literature had to be translated from European languages because there was so little of it in Arabic. In political terms, as Edward Said pointed out, Europe's 19th century Jewish question became the 20th century Palestinian question. Iraq's Jews did not live in ghettos, nor did they experience the violent repression, persecution, and genocide that marred European history. It was not without reason that Mark Mazower called his history of Europe's 20th century Dark Continent. It took Europe much longer than the Arab world to accept the Jews as equal co-citizens. In Iraq, there were stresses and strains, and one infamous pogrom against the Jews in June 1941. The overall picture, however, was one of religious tolerance, cosmopolitanism, peaceful coexistence, and fruitful interaction. Undeniably, the status of the Jews of Islam could be contentious at times, but it is both confused and confusing to lump all these issues together under the umbrella of the Jewish question. My family did not move from Iraq to Israel because of a clash of cultures or religious intolerance. Our universe did not collapse because we could not get along with our Muslim neighbors. The driver of our displacement was political, not religious or cultural. We became entangled in the conflict between Zionism and Arab nationalism, two rival secular ideologies. We were also caught in the crossfire of the conflict between Jews and Arabs over Palestine. This conflict developed in the aftermath of the First World War and intensified in the wake of the Second World War. In 1948, the Iraqi army participated in the Arab War against the newly proclaimed State of Israel. As a result of the Arab defeat, there was a backlash against the Jews throughout the Arab world. Zionism was one of the primary causes of this backlash. It gave the Jews a territorial base for the first time in over 2,000 years. This made it easier for Islamic fundamentalists and Arab nationalists to identify the Jews in their countries with the hated Zionist enemy, and to call for their extrusion. What had been a pillar of Iraqi society was increasingly perceived as a sinister fifth column. For the Zionists, the top priority all along was to bring as many Jews as possible from all over the world to build up a state of their own. Their goal was an independent Jewish state spreading over as large a part of Palestine as possible, with as many Jews and as few Arabs as possible within its borders. Zionism was the negation of the diaspora. Until the Second World War, the activities of the Zionists had focused primarily on the large Jewish population centers of Europe. The Jews of the Middle East were regarded as inferior human material who could make only a limited contribution in the process of state building. The Holocaust led to a reversal of Zionist attitudes in this regard. By wiping out the principal human reservoir for their project, it forced the leaders of the Zionist movement to turn their attention to the East. In other words, as a result of the Holocaust, the Jews of the Middle East became, for the first time, a vital element in the Zionist project of building a sustainable Jewish majority state in Palestine. In the course of the 1948 Arab-Israeli War, over 700,000 Arabs left or were driven out from their homes in Palestine. In Arabic, this fateful year is called the Nakba, or the catastrophe. In Hebrew, it is called the War of Independence. For the Zionists, 1948 was not just a military triumph, but a historical landmark, the attainment of statehood and sovereignty, the moment when the Jews were written back into world history. Consequently, we have two radically different national narratives about 1948. One focuses on the dispossession and displacement of the native population by the Zionist aggressors. The other asserts the right of the Jews to national self-determination in their ancestral homeland. Both claim the moral high ground. What is undeniable is that the creation of Israel involved a monumental injustice to the native population. Palestinians are the main victims of the Zionist project. More than half of their number became refugees, and the name Palestine was wiped off the map. But there was another category of victims, less well-known and much less talked about, the Jews of the Arab lands. The twin currents of Arab nationalism and Zionism made it impossible for Jews and Muslims to continue to coexist peacefully in the Arab world after the birth of Israel. My memoir is about the second category of the victims of the Zionist movement, as reflected in the history of my family. I repeat, we were Arab Jews. There is no better way to define our identity prior to our displacement. Yet the term Arab Jew is fiercely disputed in Israel. You can freely describe yourself as a French Jew, a Russian Jew, a Romanian Jew, or even as a German Jew, despite the grim association between Germany and the Holocaust. But if you describe yourself as an Arab Jew, as I do, you immediately encounter opposition. The hyphen is significant. Critics of the term Arab Jew see it as confusing and conflating two separate identities. As I see it, the hyphen unites. An Arab can also be a Jew, and a Jew can also be an Arab. Some Israelis deride the notion of an Arab Jew as an ontological impossibility. Jews and Arabs are habitually depicted as oppositional figures, locked in a timeless conflict. On the Arab side, the extremists also subscribe to this straightforward bipolar view. Time and again, we are told there is a clash of cultures, an unbridgeable gulf between Muslims and Jews. The clash of civilizations thesis has become entrenched, supplying ammunition for rejectionists on both sides of the Arab-Israeli divide. The story of my family in Iraq, and that of many forgotten families like mine, points to a dramatically different picture. It harks back to an era of a more pluralist Middle East, with greater religious tolerance and a political culture of mutual respect and cooperation between different ethnic minorities. My family's story is a powerful reminder of once thriving Middle Eastern identities that have been discouraged and even suppressed to suit nationalist political agendas. My own story reveals the roots of my disenchantment with Zionism. It shows how my experience made me skeptical of Zionist discourse and why, many years later, it helped to turn me into a revisionist Israeli historian, a member of the small group of what used to be called the New Historians. In this sense, my memoir is a revisionist tract, a transgressive document, an alternative history, a challenge to the widely accepted Zionist narrative about the Jews of the Arab lands who, after the mass emigration to Israel in the 1950s, became collectively known as Mizrahim. I argue that the history of the Mizrahim has been deliberately distorted in the service of Zionist propaganda. This history may be divided into two parts: pre-1950 in the Ottoman Empire and its successor states, and post-1950 in Israel. Pre-1950, Arab-Jewish history was part and parcel of the history of the Middle East as a whole. It is impossible to make sense of this history without the regional context. Post-1950, Arab-Jewish or Mizrahi history becomes part of Israel's history and as such divorced from its wider regional environment. Zionists are only interested, obsessively interested, in the first phase of Arab-Jewish history. They are profoundly uninterested in the second. Interest in the first phase is driven not by the search for truth, but by the propaganda need to portray the Jews as the victims of endemic Arab persecution, a portrayal that is then used to justify Israel's own atrocious treatment of the Palestinians. A rich, fascinating, and multidimensional history is thus reduced to the quest for ammunition to use in the ongoing war against the Palestinians. This trend reached its climax with the manufacture of the narrative of the Jewish Nakba. According to this narrative, the forced exodus of 850,000 Jews from Arab countries after 1948 amounted to a catastrophe, a Jewish Nakba, at least on par with, if not more devastating in its consequences than the Palestinian Nakba. Variously called the Forgotten Exodus, the Forced Exodus, or the Double Exodus, the purpose of this narrative is to create a false symmetry between the fate of the two communities. This narrative is not history, it is propaganda of the victors. Honest history has to acknowledge the part played by all the governments concerned in causing this man-made tragedy. The main difference is that the Palestinian refugees, for the most part, were ethnically cleansed by the Israeli armed forces, whereas the Arab Jews, with a few exceptions, were given by the Arab governments the option of leaving or staying. My book is both a personal record of a complex past and an essay with a political argument. It is a critique of Zionism from a perspective that is rarely heard outside Israel. The three worlds of the title of the book are Baghdad, where I lived up to the age of 5, Ramat Gan, from the age of 5 to 15, and London, from the age of 15 to 18. The backdrop to the story is a seismic period in Jewish history, which saw the spread of Nazi propaganda in Iraq, the Nazi genocide of European Jewry, the partition of Palestine, the birth of the State of Israel, the origin of the Palestinian refugee problem, the mass exodus of Jews from Iraq and other Arab countries to Israel, and Ashkenazi-Sephardi tensions in the early years of statehood, tensions that in some ways persist to the present day. The trauma of anti-Semitism lies at the heart of the master narrative of universal Jewish victimization. This is Jewish history as a never-ending litany of harassment, discrimination, oppression, and persecution, culminating in the Holocaust. American Jewish historian Salo Baron disparagingly termed it the lachrymose conception of Jewish history. The true history of Jews in Europe, he argued, amounted to more than tragic suffering. But even if one concedes, for argument's sake, that the lachrymose conception describes European Jewish history, it does not do justice to the history of the Jews in the Near East. Recalling the era of cosmopolitanism and coexistence that some Jews, like my family, enjoyed in Arab countries before 1948 offers a glimmer of hope. Amid the dismal wreck of the contemporary Middle East, it's the best model we have for a better future. 2. Inventing Iraq. The rise and fall of empires in the 20th century had far-reaching consequences for Jewish life in the Middle East. British colonialism shaped the politics of modern Iraq and determined the fortunes of Iraqi Jews, including my family. Under the Ottoman Empire, which had ruled the region for the previous 5 centuries, the Jews had the legal status of Ahlul Dhimma, a protected people, or Dhimmis for short. They were subjected to a host of discriminatory regulations, including an annual poll tax, but in return, they enjoyed the protection of the central government. The Ottoman polity was despotic, ramshackle, inefficient, and corrupt, but it had one redeeming feature, namely, the autonomy it afforded its various religious and ethnic minorities to run their own affairs. The empire was Muslim, but it guaranteed in law the religious and cultural autonomy of all its minorities. Under the millet system, each confessional community was allowed to govern itself in accordance with its own laws, the laws of Muslim Sharia, Christian canon law, or Jewish halakha. The First World War brought a sudden end to Ottoman rule in the region. By entering the war on the side of Germany in 1914, the Ottoman Empire signed its own death warrant. Britain's principal ally in the war in the Near East was Hussein the Sharif of Mecca, the guardian of the Muslim holy places, a direct descendant of the Prophet Muhammad, and the head of the House of Hashem. In secret negotiations in the course of 1915, Britain promised to support the establishment of an independent Arab kingdom to be headed by the venerable Sharif if he mounted an Arab revolt against his Ottoman overlords. The Sharif of Mecca broke a taboo by allying himself with infidels against fellow Muslims. He kept his side of the bargain by deputizing his son, Prince Faisal, to lead the Arab revolt, closely cooperating with T.E. Lawrence, better known as Lawrence of Arabia. But his British allies had no intention of honoring their commitments. Britain and France imposed a victor's peace, carving up the Middle East into spheres of influence. The First World War dismantled two empires, the Austro-Hungarian Empire and the Ottoman Empire. The successor states of the former became independent states, whereas the successor states of the latter were denied independence and placed under European colonial rule with the newfangled device of mandates. The League of Nations awarded France the mandates for Syria and Lebanon, while Britain received the mandates for Iraq and Palestine. The justification for the mandates was that the Arabs were not capable of ruling themselves, and that they were not ready for democracy. In theory, the idea was to prepare a country for independence and then to hand over power. In practice, the mandates were a cover, enabling the greedy colonial powers to pursue their own political and commercial interests. Britain needed a stable and friendly Iraq because of its large oil reserves and the attractive trade routes to India it provided. But the British occupation generated ill will among the tribes and the Shi'i Muslim majority. By 1920, this provoked a full-scale nationalist revolt, which could be suppressed only by deploying a large number of troops at considerable cost to the British treasury. Colonel T.E. Lawrence pointed out to his government that the Arabs rebelled against the Turks in war not because the Turk government was notably bad, but because they wanted independence. They did not risk their lives in battle to change masters to become British subjects, but to win a show of their own. Lawrence and Gertrude Bell, the representative of the colonial office in Iraq, proposed an alternative to direct rule, exercising British influence indirectly through a dependent and therefore loyal Arab political elite, an informal empire. As well as being persuasive proponents of this, Lawrence and Bell were also great fans of Prince Faisal. Bell first met Faisal at the Paris Peace Conference in 1919 and was immediately impressed by his good looks, intelligence, evident sincerity, and good humor. Some thought she had a crush on him. The fact that Faisal was not an Iraqi, but hailed from the Hejaz in the north of the Arabian Peninsula, posed a bit of a problem. However, Winston Churchill, the colonial secretary, was persuaded that Faisal offered hope for the best and cheapest solution. Prince Faisal's leadership of the Arab revolt had won him a substantial nationalist following. In March 1920, the Syrian National Congress promulgated the Arab Kingdom of Syria. This was a self-proclaimed, unrecognized state that began as a fully and absolutely independent Arab constitutional government. The new state was to include Syria, Lebanon, Palestine, and portions of northern Mesopotamia. Faisal was elected as king and declared head of state. The constitution defined his role as a constitutional monarch in a democratic system of government. The following month, however, the League of Nations gave France the mandate over both Syria and Lebanon, while Britain was entrusted with the mandates over Iraq and Palestine. The French were as heavy-handed in dealing with political rivals in their sphere of influence as the British were in their sphere. The French were no friends of Arab nationalism, viewing the Arab revolt as British imperialism in an Arab headdress, and Faisal as the unwitting stalking horse of a duplicitous British policy calculated to undermine France's position in the Levant. Britain's conduct in the Syrian affair was typical of a great power under pressure. To preserve the alliance with another great power, it let down a minor ally. Neither France nor Britain were friends of democracy. The French called Britain Perfidious Albion, a fully deserved moniker. France, however, was no less perfidious. The three-cornered dispute came to a head in July 1920, when French forces marched on Damascus, banished Faisal into exile, and took over the government of the country. This is how the modern state of Syria was created, with a republican regime under French control and on the ruins of the dream of a united and independent Arab kingdom led by the Hashemites. The episode refuted the self-serving colonial claim that the Arabs were not ready for democracy. The Arabs established a democratic regime with a constitutional monarchy, and the colonial powers stole it from them. After Faisal was driven by the French from Damascus, he was back on the royal job market, and the British manufactured for him a throne in Mesopotamia, recently renamed Iraq. Faisal's ascent to the throne in 1921 had to be carefully stage-managed because he was an outsider with no local power base. To make matters worse, he was a Sunni in a country with a disenfranchised Shi'i majority. The Shi'is suspected that the British were sponsoring Faisal in order to further entrench Sunni rule. Almost all Iraqis rejected Faisal, including the Kurds, but this did not deter the British kingmakers. First, the decks had to be cleared. The Naqib of Baghdad, who was 80 years old, was disqualified on the ground that he was too old. The British deported Sayyid Talib Pasha, a prominent nationalist leader from the province of Basra, on trumped-up charges. His crime was that he aspired to establish home rule for his country. To confirm Faisal as the monarch of the newly invented polity, his British champions organized a one-question plebiscite and rigged the results, claiming that 96% of Iraqis voted for Faisal to be their king. Many more elections would be rigged in the Arab world in later decades, but the British imperialists had the dubious distinction of being the first. The coronation of Faisal on the 23rd of August 1921 was a peculiarly British affair, orchestrated by Gertrude Bell wearing her CBE star and three war ribbons. Bell designed the flag, the heraldic coat of arms, and later on the national anthem. Faisal was crowned by the British High Commissioner for Iraq, Major General Sir Percy Zachariah Cox, GCMG, GCIE, KCSI, KBE, DL, whom the Arabs nicknamed Kokus. Sir Percy, in white uniform with all his ribbons and stars, announced from a dais set up in the courtyard of the Baghdad Sarai that Faisal had been elected king by 96% of the people of Mesopotamia. Long live the king! In front of the dais, sitting in blocks, were British colonial administrators, Iraqi ministers, and local deputations. The national flag was broken on the flagstaff, and the band played God Save the King. The Iraqis had no national anthem yet. There followed a 21-gun salute. A photograph of the coronation shows a dignified but nervous-looking Faisal sitting on a large wooden throne, and a group of rather tall British officials standing behind him on the dais. There were none of the cheering crowds that attended Faisal's inauguration in Damascus the previous year. The contrast was stark. In Damascus, Faisal was the democratically elected constitutional monarch. In Baghdad, he was the thin facade for foreign rule. Colonial Secretary Winston Churchill viewed Faisal as a vassal, indelicately pointing out that he who pays the piper calls the tune. The British not only handpicked the first ruler of Iraq, they also designed the political system of the new state in such a way as to conceal their own dominant role. As Faisal was not an Iraqi, the British had to find a suitable temporary residence for him. This task fell to Gertrude Bell, who was given a new title as the Oriental Secretary in the British High Commission in Baghdad. In her inimitable style, Bell sailed along the River Tigris in a skiff, searching for a home fit for a king. From the offers on her shortlist, Faisal chose Qasr Shashua, a large castle built on the riverbank by a wealthy Jewish tea merchant named Shaul Shashua. The magnificent residence, reputed to be the most beautiful villa in Baghdad, was rented from its owner until a proper royal palace could be built. In Qasr Shashua, as the grateful tenant of a local Jew, the new monarch settled down and assumed his royal duties. Ms. Bell helped him furnish it, establish the protocol for the royal court, and appoint ladies-in-waiting for his queen. During this crucial phase in the history of the country, Bell worked indefatigably to help the novice king in all matters large and small. In a letter to her father, Ms. Bell half-jokingly remarked, "I'll never engage in creating kings again. It's too great a strain." From now on, the British steered Iraq in close collaboration with the Hashemite monarchy and an oligarchy of pro-British politicians led by Nuri al-Said. Anyone who did not serve their imperial interests was marginalized. Nuri had been an officer in the Ottoman army, but had switched sides and fought alongside Prince Faisal in the Arab revolt against the Ottomans in the First World War. Nuri was to serve 14 terms as prime minister before meeting his grisly end in the revolution of July 1958. Gertrude Bell, who used to go horse riding with Nuri on the banks of the Tigris River, had many close friends among the Iraqi political elite and very considerable influence in shaping the country's fortunes. In the early years of Faisal's reign, she was sometimes referred to as the uncrowned queen of Iraq. In this Anglo-Hashemite political system, there was a pompous parliamentary facade, but no democracy and no peaceful means for bringing about political change. Thus, from the beginning, an anti-British sentiment was evident in Iraqi politics. Britain's fundamental mistake was to erect an upside-down pyramid, which gave the Sunni elite a monopoly of power and marginalized the Shi'i majority. This British-made state exacerbated Iraq's inherent structural problems and brought no freedom, no peace, and no happiness to its people. Equally arbitrary and equally calculated to suit Britain's own political, strategic, and commercial interests was the delineation of Iraq's borders. These borders took little account of the divisions within Iraq along linguistic or religious lines. The main groups were the Kurds in the northeast, the Sunnis in the central area around Baghdad and in the northwest, and the Shi'is in the south. In addition, there were several minorities, including Assyrians, Armenians, Turkmen, and Jews. Originally, Iraq was going to be made up out of two Ottoman provinces, Basra and Baghdad. But later, the oil-bearing province of Mosul was added to Iraq, dashing Kurdish hopes, based on the Treaty of Sèvres of 1920, for an autonomous Kurdish state. The logic behind the enterprise was cleverly summed up by one observer. Iraq was created by Churchill, who had the mad idea of joining two widely separated oil wells, Kirkuk and Mosul, by uniting three widely separated peoples, the Kurds, the Sunnis, and the Shiites. The three provinces were very different and had never previously been governed together. Cobbling them together by imperial fiat ensured that the new polity was fragmented and fractured from the beginning. As we say in Arabic, something that starts crooked remains crooked. In Iraq's case, the original fault lines of the polity remained in place, and if anything, became more pronounced with the passage of time. The Kurds resented Britain for reneging on its promise of independence, the Shiites for marginalizing them, and the Sunnis for curbing their nationalist aspirations. The army, which the British trained and equipped, became the breeding ground of nationalist opposition to the British overlords and their local protégés. A major cause of resentment during the Mandate era was the British practice of divide and rule between the three major segments of the population, Kurds, Sunnis, and Shiites. The Sunnis were the smallest of the three communities, but they had the lion's share of power, privilege, and patronage. During the Mandate, government departments and state institutions were run predominantly by Sunnis, aided by their British advisors. Another source of frustration for Iraqi nationalists was the British policy of giving preferential treatment to ethnic and religious minorities, notably Christians and Jews. These minorities were favored because they were less likely to be drawn to nationalist causes than the rest of the population. The British also favored the Assyrians on the border with Syria and the Bedouin tribal sheikhs in the countryside. Of all the Jewish communities in the Ottoman Empire, the one in Mesopotamia was the most integrated into local society, the most Arabized in its culture, and the most prosperous. When the British created the Kingdom of Iraq, they found a vibrant Jewish community, led by the chief rabbi and committees of notables, merchants who controlled much of the import and export trade with extensive links to Bombay and Calcutta in India, and bankers and sarafs, or moneylenders, who provided much of the finance to keep the wheels of commerce turning. Although they constituted only 2% of Iraq's population, they controlled 75% of its imports. The Baghdad Chamber of Commerce in 1935 consisted of 9 Jews, 4 Muslims, and 2 Britons. In short, the Jews were the backbone of the Iraqi economy. The first Iraqi Minister of Finance was a cosmopolitan Jew, Sir Sassoon Esquil, 1860-1932, better known by his Ottoman honorific title, Sassoon Effendi. Scion of an ancient and aristocratic Jewish family of great influence, he had received his primary education in the Alliance Israélite Universelle in Baghdad, and his higher education in economics and law in Constantinople, Vienna, and London. He knew 9 languages, English, Arabic, Turkish, Persian, Hebrew, French, German, Greek, and Latin. In his early career, he served as a deputy in the Ottoman Parliament. Then in 1925, he was elected as a deputy to the first Iraqi Parliament, and re-elected until his death, earning the informal title Father of Parliament. As minister, he established the kingdom's financial and budgetary structures and laws. Gertrude Bell considered him the ablest minister in the government, the most selfless, and the most far-sighted. Esquil was opposed to the Zionist takeover of Palestine and to the goal of turning it into a Jewish state, foreseeing that a Jewish state in Palestine would create a Jewish problem in the rest of the lands of the former Ottoman Empire. Few Jewish families, apart from the Sassoons, belonged to the old aristocracy of the new kingdom. My family belonged to the upper middle class of affluent Jews. My mother attended a Jewish school for girls in Baghdad and made friends with the daughters of Sassoon Effendi, Hilda and Rachel, the latter later marrying one of my mother's relatives. As indicative of Sassoon Effendi's wisdom, my mother pointed out that it was he who had insisted that Britain pay Iraq's oil royalties not in rupees, but in gold coins. She upheld him as a prime example of the contribution that the Jewish community had made to the building of the Iraqi state. The Jewish middle class included not only merchants and financiers, but members of the free professions like doctors, lawyers, academics, and journalists. Below them was a substantial layer of lower middle class Jews, and lower down the social hierarchy there were poor Jews, many of whom lived in the Abu Sufayn neighborhood. Jews, like the rest of Iraqi society, could be found in most professional occupations, such as plumbers, electricians, carpenters, cobblers, tailors, and hairdressers. Jewelry making with gold and silver was a Jewish specialty. In the north of the country, there were some Jewish farmers, but they were a tiny fraction of the total Jewish population. Some businesses, like those producing kosher food, had only Jews among their clients. In most other spheres, however, interaction between Jews and Muslims was a normal feature of everyday life. Baghdad, which regained its status as a capital city after 5 centuries of Ottoman rule, had a mixed population of Sunnis, Shiis, Christians, and Jews, all Arabic-speaking. The Jews were the largest group with a continuous record of living in Mesopotamia. Their lineage stretched as far back as Babylonian times, predating the rise of Islam by a millennium. They excelled in every aspect of national endeavor, playing a prominent part in the development of Iraqi health, education, and transport systems. Their influence was evident in every branch of Iraqi culture, from literature and music to journalism and the media. Banks, with the exception of government-owned banks, and all the big markets remained closed on the Sabbath and on the other Jewish holy days. After the fall of the Ottomans, the Jews in Iraq welcomed the arrival of the British, believing it would bring security and stability to the fractious country, expand commercial opportunities, and uphold the same rights that were enjoyed by the Jews in the rest of the British Empire. Although they initially favored direct British rule, the Jews quickly rallied behind King Faisal and joined in his project of building a new state. Shortly after Faisal's ascent to the throne, the Iraqi Jewish community organized a grand reception in his honor. It was held in the Great Synagogue in the presence of many of the city's notables. Faisal kissed the Torah, which was brought out for him from the Ark of the Covenant, and in his speech he thanked the Jews, whom he described as the living spirit of the population of Iraq. In the 1920s, Iraqi Jews developed what was often referred to as an Iraqi orientation, which meant living as equal citizens and playing an active part in developing Iraq for the benefit of all its inhabitants. The appointment of Sir Sassoon Esquel to one of the top government positions reinforced this orientation. Faisal did not disappoint his Jewish subjects. He was an enlightened monarch who genuinely believed in equal rights for all his subjects, and in trying to merge all the different sections of the population into a united Iraqi nation. In his speeches, Faisal repeatedly stressed that there was no difference between Muslims, Christians, and Jews. They were all Iraqis, and they all belonged to the Semitic race. His father had educated him to respect the Jews, who are referred to in the Quran as the people of the book. Gertrude Bell encouraged Faisal to reach out to his Jewish subjects, to visit their schools and synagogues, and to praise the part they played in the project of nation-building publicly. At the same time, she encouraged the Jews to look to Faisal for their protection and welfare. The 1924 Constitution enshrined the principle of equality before the law, regardless of religion and race, and included measures to enable minorities to preserve their religious and cultural autonomy. The Jews were granted representation in both houses of parliament in proportion to their population. They were allowed to rise to senior positions in the civil service in line with their educational attainments, professional qualifications, and managerial skills. For the most part, however, prominent Jews avoided involvement in pan-Arabism, an ideology that espoused the unification of the Arab states. There were several reasons for this. First, they belonged to a non-Muslim minority, and as such did not fit in easily into radical anti-British pan-Arab sentiment. Second, although they were involved in party politics mainly on the left-wing and liberal side, they preferred to keep their distance from mass movements and region-wide political struggles. Nevertheless, the prominence of the Jews in the economy and in the bureaucracy cast a shadow over Muslim-Jewish relations. Success in financial and other spheres gave rise to jealousy that could translate into active antagonism. Some Muslims regarded the Jews as traitors to the national aspirations of the Iraqi people. Others, especially on the extreme right-wing fringes of Iraqi politics, went even further by denouncing the Jews as the agents of British imperialism. The Jews were well aware of their vulnerable position, but they felt they had few political alternatives. As far as they were concerned, the British were not just the all-powerful rulers of Iraq, but also the champions of minorities and the representatives of Western culture. The end of the British mandate in October 1932 brought formal independence, but only minor changes in the way the country was run. Like the nationalists, King Faisal was disappointed with an agreement that did not bring about genuine self-rule. But having been booted out by the French from his throne in Damascus, he was wary of provoking a showdown with his British masters, preferring to proceed step by step towards the goal of real independence. For the time being, he continued the delicate balancing act between the British and the more extreme Iraqi nationalists. But time ran out on him. On the 8th of September 1933, King Faisal died unexpectedly and mysteriously while undergoing a general medical checkup in a clinic in Bern, Switzerland. He was only 50 years old. The official cause of death was a heart attack. No autopsy was conducted. His body was hurriedly embalmed and flown back to Baghdad. Many questions were raised about Faisal's sudden death, especially as the Swiss doctors maintained that he was healthy and that there was nothing wrong with him when he arrived. His private nurse reported signs of arsenic poisoning before his death. Although my mother was only 9 years old at the time of the king's death, she remembers people weeping in the street and singing a song which cursed Switzerland. Many Iraqis of that generation, including my mother, believed that it was the British who had secretly ordered the poisoning of the popular king because he had outlived his usefulness. The death of King Faisal was a tragic milestone in the history of Iraq, marking the end of a liberal, religiously pluralist era. Iraqi politics became increasingly dominated by the deeply authoritarian and staunchly pro-British Nuri al-Said. Nuri was a wily character, frequently referred to as the Old Fox. He personified the innate conservatism of the Iraqi ruling class. Such was Nuri's dominance that the next 25 years in Iraqi history were often referred to as Ahad Nuri, or Nuri's era. During the first decade of the kingdom, Nuri was a powerful ally of the Jews, but his attitude would change in the aftermath of the Second World War, partly because of Jewish involvement in the Iraqi Communist Party, partly because of the Zionist offensive in Palestine. Faisal was succeeded by his only son, Ghazi. Ghazi was 21 years old when he ascended the throne. He hated the British because of their betrayal of his grandfather, Hussein the Sharif of Mecca, and their betrayal of the Arabs by issuing the Balfour Declaration. Unlike his worldly father, Ghazi was an inexperienced and unbalanced young man, immature and debauched, assiduous in pursuit of pleasure and sport, but neglectful of his public duties. He held some half-baked but strongly expressed pan-Arab views and dabbled in Nazi ideology and the notion of racial purity. My mother spoke of Ghazi as a huge disappointment compared to his father, and as a scoundrel who got mixed up in bad company, notably the Nazis and Haj Amin al-Husseini, the leader of the Palestinian National Movement. During Ghazi's short reign, the nationalists became more outspoken and more assertive in Iraqi politics. Following the rise to power of the Nazi Party in 1933, German propaganda stepped up in Iraq. The Germans had their eyes on Iraq's oil, and their propaganda machine skillfully pandered to anti-British and anti-Zionist feelings. Admiration for Germany spread through the country. German replaced French as the second foreign language after English in some schools. The Ministry of Education encouraged the formation of the Futuwa, the youth, a paramilitary brigade modeled on the Hitler Youth, which took to harassing Jews on the streets of Baghdad. Nazi militarism made a strong impression on members of the younger generation who aspired to set up a Nazi movement in Iraq. Hostility towards the Jews, whatever its sources, had found a new and toxic ideological justification. The German ambassador, Dr. Fritz Grobe, who was an Arabic speaker, made many friends among the local politicians and the journalists. He bought a Christian-owned newspaper, Al-Alam Al-Arabi, the Arab World, and he serialized there an Arabic version of Adolf Hitler's autobiography, Mein Kampf. Ghazi befriended Grobe. Secular and religious nationalists, previously sidelined by the British, now found in Grobe a sympathetic ally. With Grobe's encouragement, the army voiced ever more strident anti-Jewish and anti-imperialist sentiments, and began to intervene in the political arena against civilian governments it considered insufficiently patriotic. In 1936, with the tacit support of the king, four army officers nicknamed the Golden Square overthrew the civilian government. This was the first coup d'etat in modern Arab politics. On Ghazi's watch, xenophobia in the country at large, in the media, and in government circles, resulted in a move to cancel the special status and privileges which his father had granted.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.